This is the first test of my robotics project.
Stop!
The seventh test.
This is Tadashi, my older brother.
33rd test.
Wait, stop!
This is the 84th test.
Hello, I am Baymax.
It works! Oh, this is amazing!
I wanted to help a lot of people. People keep saying Tadashi's not really gone. As long as we remember him.
Hello, I am Baymax. Tadashi programmed me to heal the sick and injured. You will be all right. There. I would like to help. Scan complete. You are experiencing mood swings. Diagnosis? Puberty.
Whoa, what?
It's like spooning a warm marshmallow.
Reports are flooding in about a major catastrophe.
We're under attack from a supervillain, people!
Come on, go!
I am not fast.
Yeah, no kidding!
So a man in a kabuki mask attacked you in Balloon Man.
We gotta catch him!
We can't go against that guy! We're nerds!
Trust me, I know about robotics. We can be way more.
Anybody else's suit riding up on him? Come on! Kick it down! Just punch it!
Why is Baymax wearing carbon fiber underpants?
This may undermine my non-threatening huggable design.
He's glorious.
On top of the world! On top of it all! Trying to feel invincible!
I wasn't terrified of heights. I'd probably love this. But I'm terrified of heights, so I don't love it.
What's wrong with you?
Low battery. Hairy baby.
That was amazing!
You gave me a heart attack.
Clear.
Stop! It's just an expression.
What do you say, buddy?
Whee! Okay, let's get you back in your luggage.
Well, obviously, that movie came out last year. Yeah, how many of you guys saw that movie? Just by a show of hands. Because I'm going to be talking a lot about the movie, and I'm going to spoil it for you. So if you haven't seen it, I don't apologize. But go ahead and watch the movie. It's an amazing, amazing movie. And it's the favorite movie in our house right now. So we probably watched it maybe about 87 times, but who's counting, you know? Emmett loves the movie. He watches it every day. He likes the music, of course, the colors. How many of you guys love Pixar movies? I love Pixar movies and the sound. But also, you know, beyond all that as well, you know, it really does appeal to adults, right? So if, you know, adults, if you think that that's just a kid's movie, really it's not. You know, they really appeal to a lot of the age groups, all age groups. And so, you know, we can certainly learn, you know, biblical truths that are in the movies. That's why we do what we do. And I'm pretty sure Pastor Teresa talked about it last week, where, you know, every summer we do our blockbuster series. And this is kind of like what Pastor Mike, he loves to do, and we've kind of adopted it as we love doing it as well. But, you know, in the summertime, we all know that there's all kinds of movies that come out, right? And I don't know if you guys, you know, pay attention to the movies that are coming out, you know, Avengers and all these kinds of things, all these big movies that are expected to pull in a lot of money. And I also am aware, in case you're not aware, but, you know, I just want to just throw it out there just to let you know that we're not ignorant to this. But there's a group of people, even Christians, that say, oh, you know, as Christians, you shouldn't watch movies. How many of you have ever come across that kind of conversation? I mean, you know, they're out there. But I just want to say that I understand where they're coming from. And the reason being is because movies are powerful. Everybody say that. Movies are powerful. Powerful in what? Powerful in conveying ideals. Powerful in conveying philosophies. Powerful in conveying truths. But on the other hand as well, they're very powerful in conveying worldly ideals. And we can quickly get our mind muddled if you know what I'm saying. And so a lot of people, you know, they I don't know, could be propaganda, you know, from the Hollywood, you know, culture that is out there, you know, the liberals and all these kinds of things, you know, we don't have to get into that. But nonetheless, movies are very powerful mediums to communicate truths. And that's the reason why we do that. And of course, what we believe in as a church, New Hope Central Oahu, is really redeeming everything about our culture for Christ. Can I get an amen? And so that's the reason why we do these things. And it's also fun. It's also fun to really, you know, watch these movies and to really bring these truths out, because it's kind of been a game in our house. And, you know, Teresa is always like, oh, did you find out? Did you hear what they said in the movie? You know, all these kinds of things. And really it becomes a topic of discussion for us. And that's how we kind of choose to raise our kids. So if you're part of that, you know, party that says, oh, as Christians, we shouldn't watch movies, I understand. But at the same time, as Christians, we need to be careful what we watch. Can I get an amen? Because how many of you know that the eyes are the windows to our soul? Now, what does that mean? Well, of course, you probably heard that we have two ears, one mouth, right? Which means that we should listen twice as much as we speak, right? right? I mean, so what we hear really is powerful. What we see is also very, very powerful, okay? And so when we watch these movies, and then so we kind of preview these movies, you know, sometimes rated R movies, you know, I'll watch them, you know, but I kind of rarely watch them because of the cussing that's in it, maybe the subject matter, maybe there's too much sexual content, and all these kinds of things. So I rarely watch it. You know, once in a while, you know, okay, but you know, you gotta be careful about those kinds of things. Some of the PG-13 movies, wouldn't you agree, brothers and sisters, should be rated R? Yeah. We need to be aware of these things, right? But again, do not be afraid of having conversations with your kids. You know, we believe in inoculating them, right? Because they're gonna get the world from someplace. You're going to get these worldly views, ungodly views from the world. You know, it creeps up on them in social media. It creeps up on them through cable TV, all these kinds of things. So I want to encourage you again to keep having these conversations with your kids and help them to understand, okay, that is violates God's laws, and this is why. This encourages God's laws, and this is why. You know, so have those types of conversations. And what I like to think is that, how many of you believe that Jesus Christ was a master storyteller? And you guys may have talked about this last week, right? And that's why Jesus spoke in parables, okay? And I remember reading about one of his disciples asking him, why do you speak in parables, master? And it was and Jesus' reply, his response was, because those with ears to hear will hear, those with eyes to see will see. But Jesus was talking about how it's going to get divided. People will understand or begin to see these truths in everyday lives, and then there's going to be a separation where people will just deny it altogether. And so I want to encourage you, brothers and sisters, that Jesus or God does not exist only on Sundays. Can we agree? Mondays through Saturdays as well. That is the very meaning of why God is omnipresent, omnipotent. He is all-knowing, he is all-present, he is everywhere. The challenge is sometimes we as believers only see him on Sundays, right? And so I encourage you to keep your spiritual antennas up, right? And see God in everything. See God's truths in everything. You know, what was interesting. And for those of you that don't know who I am, by the way, I'm Pastor Glenn. I co-pastor this campus with my beautiful wife, Pastor Teresa. I was on military duty last week. So in case we haven't met, thank you for worshiping with us this morning. Hallelujah. Last week, we were at formation, right? Being in the military. If you guys are in the military, you guys understand what I'm talking about. But, you know, after formation, the executive officer, he calls all the officers together, right? And so we stand around in a circle just to kind of brief each other, keep each other abreast of what's going on. We were in the middle of a logistics exercise, and then unfortunately there was a group of people that were kind of bickering and arguing and going back and forth at each other. And so the executive officer, the XO, he looks at me, because you know I'm the chaplain, to kind of help with the personal conflict issues that are going on, right? So I do my best, right? But I kind of, in the military, it's a different world, because even though you can speak freely, you got to be careful because these guys kind of outrank you sometimes. But anyway, so the XO, he says, okay, let's gather around in a circle. So we gathered around in a circle, and then he proceeded to just scold everybody because they weren't getting along. They were arguing, you know, because, you know, they were getting heated with all these conversations. And basically, the XO said, a house divided against itself will not stand. Okay? A house divided against itself will not stand. So, of course, he was talking about unity in the body of Christ. And then immediately, when the XO said that, one of the captains, he was the operations officer, he goes, Abraham Lincoln! Right? So I looked over at the operations officer. I looked at him. I said, yeah, you're right. You know, after the Civil War, Abraham Lincoln did do a speech called the A House Divided speech. Okay, and he was famous for that. But where did Abraham Lincoln get it from? He got it from Jesus. Right? But the operations officer, he didn't know that. And I wasn't going to say anything because it wasn't the proper place, you know, and he wasn't wrong. But, you know, I just kind of chuckled to myself, and the XO kind of looked at me, and he kind of laughed, because I know the XO, he's a believer as well. I believe he attended one of the New Hopes downtown. But he looks at me, and he kind of did one of those things, you know. And then I kind of giggled, because the operations officer, he knew where it came from. He was not incorrect. But here's my point, brothers and sisters. Let's just go to the source. Right? Let's just go to the source. Just to say, oh yeah, Jesus said that. Right? Abraham Lincoln did say that, but Abraham Lincoln got it from Jesus. Okay? You can look it up in Matthew 12, Mark 3. Okay? In the Synoptic Gospels. Okay? A house divided against itself shall not stand. Now, when we look at the movies, brothers and sisters, oftentimes there's biblical truths in movies. Wouldn't you agree? And again, we talked about how, you know, we make it a game and you know, make it a game of pulling out these truths. But let's just go to the source, right? And what I mean by that is we got to get cozy with our Bibles. We got to get intimate with our Bibles. We got to get intimate with the Word of God. We got to know the Word of God. Because Jesus said in John 10:4, when he feeds his sheep will know his voice. So when we watch these movies, like, ah, okay, we can kind of ping that back to a scripture. Okay, so that's where we're coming from. Okay, that's the reason why we do these blockbuster series. And of course, it'll encourage you, it'll help you to engage in conversations while you're at work. Amen. What's so funny is when, you know, when the Fuel family was up here, can we give them a round of applause again? Rich doesn't want me to do it, but You know, Rich, I was thinking, this is the thought that came to my mind. You know, I was standing over here, and then I was just marveling, really, at all the many wonderful years that the Rosario family have been ministering with the Fuel family and many other families in this wonderful congregation as well. But I was looking at Brian. I was thinking, you know, Big Hero 6?
Yeah, it's totally.
Hiro Hamada? We have a very own Hiro Hamada right here. Who's just smart, you know, and just very intellectual. And the thing is that you know, there's always a conflict. Now, you know, I don't want to go down a tangent or a rabbit trail or anything like that, but there's a conflict between science and faith. Okay? If you're not aware of that, and you know, I have to say that as a pastor, you know, Brian will go into that world. Creationism, evolution. He's going to go into a world full of scientists and engineers. Okay, now I'm sure Rich and Emily have had this kind of conversation with Brian. But what I do want to say about that is that scientists only prove what God put there in the first place. That's my belief. Okay? So, you know, use that. Maybe you can put that in your pocket, you know, and you can bring that out, you know, if need be.
Jesus.
But, you know, I remember having a conversation. I remember having a conversation, and I may have told this story many, many times, but I told a story where a good friend of mine, we were in the Air Force together, and he's this logical guy, you know, very, very smart. He thinks very linearly, very logically. Computers, you know, that type of thing. And then he went from being an agnostic to an atheist. So for those of you that don't know the difference, an agnostic is somebody who's on the fence, who says, there may be a God, there may not be a God. And so I had a conversation with him. I said, you know, are you still an agnostic or are you an atheist? Did you choose a side? And then he said, yes, I am now an atheist. I believe there is no God. So I said, okay, why do you believe that? You know, so we engaged in conversation. And I told him the exact same line. You know, you're only discovering what God already placed there. And that stumped him. Okay? So I was like, yeah. You know? I was able to poke a hole in what he believed. And what they're finding now is that it takes more faith for a scientist to believe in their claims than it is for a Christian to exercise their faith in their faith. Okay, now we won't go into that, but I just want to say that, you know, as we, maybe for you, you're at your workplace and you're maybe having a conversation with somebody who's trying to rationalize this. You know, why sense have a God if there's no mystery to it? You know what I mean? You're not equal to God. You will never be equal to God, so there will always be a mystery to God. And that is why we have faith. Amen. But that's all I just want to say about that. Amen. More to come. As we develop, we're going to actually be developing a Truth Academy class about those kinds of things. And that's going to be in September. So that's a little plug for you. So kind of look out for that. We're going to be developing that class. So going back to the screen, Avengers, $1.4 billion, right? You guys talked about this last week. Huge, huge money. It appeals to a lot of people, right? Shoot 'em up, explosions, bang, lasers, you know, superheroes. It's just fun. You can turn off your brain and you can watch it. You can watch all this excitement on the big screen, right? But a lot of it is seeping into our brain. What did you guys talk about last week? Basically the eradication of evil, right? So the idea is when you're at work and then somebody comes up to you and says, why does, if God exists, why does God allow evil in this world? Right? I don't know, maybe you guys have kind of gone through that kind of conversation. If God is so good, why does he allow evil in this world? And then you can say, did you see the movie Avengers? Right? You know, where they wanted to develop this utopian world, right? A utopian world where everything is perfect, right? But it's all man-made, right? But in the end, really, a utopian world really excludes the existence of God, okay? And that's dangerous because if you allow that to happen, that means the devil won. The devil cannot get rid of God because the created cannot get rid of the creator. But the devil succeeds at diverting your attention away from God, okay? So now when we think about Going back to my operations officer, when he said, you know, a house divided against itself shall not stand. Well, that was Abraham Lincoln, right? You see how his attention was diverted away from God. His attention was diverted away from the source. You see what I mean? So it's very subtle. But we've got to be careful about those kinds of things. We talk about Big Hero 6 today. Big Hero 6, $650 million. Again, it's a big, big, huge, huge movie that came out. Next week, we're going to be talking about McFarlane, USA. How many of you guys are familiar with that movie? McFarlane, USA. It's a great underdog movie. Stay tuned for that. And I want to encourage you, you know, go look it up on YouTube and go find out if you haven't seen the movies. Go look at their trailers. You know, maybe kind of get a little taste of what these movies are. Inside Out, stay tuned for that. That's going to be a good one. Pastor Teresa is going to be giving that one. And it's, you know, again, the colors are very vibrant. The characters in the movie are very just wonderful. But it's a very mature topic when it comes to emotions, right? So stay tuned for that. When the game stands tall, it's about football, right? And the idea of brotherhood and integrity and just being there for one another. Six, Jurassic World. How many of you guys saw Jurassic World? Yeah, all right. We love that one too because it's just the awesomeness of God, right? The wonders of God's creation. So stay tuned for that. Pastor Teresa is always worried that I'm going to give it away, but I'm trying to set her up. Build the excitement. Okay, but stay tuned for that. And the reason why we tell you that, brothers and sisters, is because, you know, you're going to go home, and you're going to think of your loved ones, your family, your friends, your coworkers, and then you might say to yourself, you know what? So-and-so might be able to relate to this. You know, let me go invite them, right? And then you kind of pick and choose which weekend you want to invite your friends, and then you bring them along. You see? You see how that works?
Yes.
Amen? Okay, so here is a quote that you guys talked about last week as well. I loved it so much, I wanted to repeat it. Parables are common earthly stories used to reveal heavenly truth. Parables are common earthly stories used to reveal heavenly truth. Of course, it's not in your notes, but go ahead and write that in. Okay, it's a great one to memorize. Parables are common earthly stories used to reveal heavenly truth. And I'm here to tell you that perhaps movies are our modern-day parables, right? You know, we believe that Jesus was a masterful storyteller. Jesus was also in tune with the culture that he was preaching to, and the people that he was endeavoring to reach out to. Amen. We live in a society where the cinema is just huge, just a huge part of our culture, right? You saw the statistics, 140 billion, 1.4 billion. You saw that, so you know what drives our culture. So when we speak the language of our culture, all right, you kind of play them at their game. Wouldn't you agree? And that's what Jesus did. Jesus was a master at that. And I believe if Jesus walked the earth today, he'd be making some references to the movies, right? But we don't have Jesus. We have the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit has the ability to speak to us through these movies as well. You see how that works? So as we talk about Big Hero 6, and I'm going to kind of give you a brief synopsis of Big Hero 6 before I call up Brother Kurt, okay? But Big Hero 6, you see that boy right in the middle of the screen there with the red shirt and the blue jacket. That's Hiro Hamada. And the story is he graduated high school when he was 13. And I believe he's 14 now, but he's just a genius. I don't know, an IQ of 200 or something like that. And he's basically, in his brother's mind, kind of wasting his life because he just kind of involved in the underground world of bot fighting, robot fighting. So what he does in his spare time is he's so smart that he develops all these robots, kind of like the Fuel family, okay? Develops all these robots, and then they go out and they fight these robots. So you know what I was thinking? It's kind of like a real smart kid from Punahou, okay? And what he does is he raises chickens in his backyard and he just fights chicken all day. You know, not that I know of, you know, being Filipino, I don't know. But it's kind of like that, right? I mean, you just raise chickens all day, you go fight chicken. That's all you do, right? And of course he gambles and he bets and all these kinds of things. So his brother comes in because their parents pass away when he was 3, I believe. So his brother Tadashi now becomes like a paternal figure for him and just looking out for him, making sure he's using his talents for good, okay? And so he tells Hiro, hey man, you know, why don't you come check out our school, right? And his nerd school where they develop, you know, different technology and all these kinds of things. But the idea behind this school is to develop this technology, kind of like what Brian is going to do, right, with the satellites and all this kind of stuff. But really, it's to benefit mankind, okay? So you see, right off the bat, we see the idea of having a purpose in life, living a life that is bigger than yours, maybe leaving your mark on life. Pastor Teresa's sister used to work on the satellites when she was in the Air Force. She was working on the satellites. She was part of the team that launched the satellites for GPS. So for those of you that use GPS, she was part of the team that launched the satellites that did that. And this is in Colorado, you know? So you live your life knowing that you're going to leave your mark and it's going to benefit mankind. And that's what Tadashi was trying to get Hiro to see, instead of fighting chicken all morning, okay? Fighting chickens all day, if you will. And so, unfortunately, there was an explosion, there was a fire. Tadashi dies in the accident, okay? So you see a picture of, this is Tadashi's colleagues, his friends, right? Tadashi invents the robot Baymax, and then now they kind of hanai him in as a family. And they support him through the grieving process, and they help to remind Hiro of his talents and what he was designed to do, and to use his talents productively. Okay, so that is where we're going to start off. Well, actually, I should also say that Hiro, after he grieves, he wants to exact revenge on who he thought murdered his brother. Okay, his friends later on help him to see that it wasn't a murder, that it was an accident. So just like Scooby-Doo, they kind of solve the mystery, right? They help each other, and then Hiro is able to heal through the process. He's able to find his identity, and again, to help his friends find their identity as well, okay? So with that said, I want to call up my brother, Kurt, okay? And I'm going to have... Oh, you can come up here. Yeah. We can have a... Well, I asked brother Kurt to come up here and just to share a little bit of what's been on his heart. And I'm going to kind of tie it in a little bit later, but Brother Kurt has been, you know, we've been ministering with him for many, many years now, since way back into the Milana EK days, and he's just a wonderful minister of the Lord. He's been working with a lot of the men's groups, a lot of men's individually, one-on-one. He's been involved with the youth groups at all three campuses as well. And the Lord put it on his heart to share this with you. And then he came up to me and I said, you know what, let's wait on the Lord a little bit, let's share, and the Lord will tell us the proper time as to what he wants you to share. So please welcome him and have at it. Thanks, Kurt.
Oh, good morning. I'm Kurt. Man of God, I want you to write this down right now. Right now, take out your pens. 753-0905. 753-0905. That is my phone number. Okay, you can text me. Just add 808. With great joy, I get to announce that we are restarting the men's ministry for Haleiwa. It's a time where men can get together, go through our struggles, go through our hurts, celebrate our victories, encourage each other, because men have unique issues. It's a place where you can come and be yourself. You don't have to put on airs. We accept you. We love you the way you are. Now Creighton and I have been doing men's ministry since 2008. One of the biggest issues, always in the top three for men that we find, is lust. Lust. Lust destroys relationships. It destroys marriages. It destroys families. When sex is not contained within marriage, it will destroy. I know, 2008, I got divorced because of my sexual immorality. My family's destroyed because of that. Creighton and I minister to men going through divorce. A big contributing factor in almost all of them is sexual immorality. And it's time that we take a stand. We're not gonna bury it. We're not gonna just ignore it. We're gonna address it in this group. The Lord wants you all to be set free. And it is bondage. It is bondage. And I'm here to tell you, you can win. The Lord can break it off you, where lust is just another sin, like stealing something or lying, where you can just bounce it off. Now, lust affects every relationship in your life. I'm talking to you, man. Your relationship with your wife or your future wife, your relationship with your kids or your future kids. Most importantly, it hinders your relationship with God. Some of you have difficulty hearing from the Lord. Get clean, get free. You'll be amazed at how, even if you can hear from the Lord fine, how it takes it to the next level. You can renew all your relationships through this. Even broken ones can be mended. The Lord doesn't want you to be bound up anymore. He wants you to be free. So men of God, I encourage you to come. Not just for your sake, but for your family's sake. Be able to look in your spouse or your future spouse's eyes and say, yes, I am clean. I only look at you, no one else. Wouldn't you like your daughter to marry someone who doesn't lust after anyone else, who just desires you? This is a very important topic. We want all men to come because now it's not shame anymore. It's in the open. I mean, after a year doing this, we can talk about all kinds of things that men never thought they'd talk about even 2 months going into the study, where it's like we're talking about washing the dishes or something. And it will set you free. Women of God, pray for your husbands. Love them. They all fall short. We all live in a sinful world. Encourage them to come. We're going to start on August 17th. We're going to meet 7 o'clock at the Holly Eva McDonald's to start. And we'll see if God changes the venue for us. And we're going to meet every other week. So encourage the man in your life to attend so that he can fellowship and get free. And let's, if we don't fight, we're letting Satan win the battle, and we're not about that. We're going to take up our arms, and we're going to fight. We're going to fight for every family here. And let's all do it together. Thank you.
Amen. Let's give Brother Kurt a round of applause. Thank you. Thank you. So I want to encourage you, brothers and sisters, to take that number down. You can also exchange emails with him. Brother Creighton is also a wonderful resource as well. Get together with them. And just get connected, you know. And what I love about these kinds of programs is because they're very specific, we're going to find that you know, these are brothers that you can rely on. They essentially become accountability partners for you. You don't have to air out your laundry in front of everyone, but you know, as we go through the message this morning, you're going to see how the Word of God encourages us to find that one or two, you know, brothers in your life, you know, for sisters with sisters, brothers and brothers, to find those sisters in your life that you can just fillet yourself open with. You know, we find that a lot of men tend to be a little bit more prideful. You know, and it's because, nah, brah, I get them, brah. You know, that we have that kind of attitude, that kind of macho attitude. I'm guilty of that as well. But I found that, you know, when you are able to just humble yourself and just to fillet yourself open, it's liberating, right? Can we agree to that? So as we read in the Word today, you know, you're going to see the similarities and the parallelisms of what Kurt is offering the body of Christ, or what the Lord is offering through Kurt, through the body of Christ, and be able to see how God can also move in your life as well. Amen. So as we open up to Ecclesiastes 4, that was a very long intro, yeah? Ecclesiastes 4. Let's pray real quick, if you could bow your heads with me. Father God, we come before you and we thank you for all that you have done thus far this morning. And as we dig into your word, Lord God, speak to us, teach us, and guide us. For you are a wonderful counselor. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Ecclesiastes 4, starting with verse 7. Okay, so this is Solomon speaking. And he's saying this: I observed yet another example of something meaningless under the sun. This is the case of a man who is all alone without a child or a brother, yet who works hard to gain as much wealth as he can. But then he asks himself, who am I working for? Why am I giving up so much pleasure now? It is all so meaningless and depressing. Now, you know, it took a while for me to kind of get into Solomon because, you know, when I was reading Solomon, he sounds like he's very pessimistic sometimes, kind of down in the dumps kind of a guy, you know. And so as I was reading this, I was like, okay, what is he trying to say? Basically what he's saying is that if you're working hard, and working hard is good, but if you don't have anybody to share it with, it becomes meaningless. Now, we can agree to that, right? He would rather work as much as him, he would rather work hard to enjoy, you know, whatever he wants to enjoy, and then just kind of slack off a little bit. You know, I don't know, maybe we can kind of think of it that way. But the bottom line is this, brothers and sisters, if you have somebody to work for, then it becomes meaningful and edifying. Okay, so we're going to unwrap that a little bit. Focusing on others is always meaningful and edifying. Have you ever done something for someone? How did that make you feel? Right? Just out of the goodness of your heart, without expecting anything in return. It feels good, doesn't it? Right? Right? It feels good. I remember one time, you know, we were sitting at a Korean restaurant, one of our favorite Korean restaurants, both Teresa and myself. And in walks in, you know, we were kind of like maybe halfway through our meal. And then in walks in Pastor Earl and his wife, Gail. Now, that was the week of Pastor Earl's birthday. But I remember he was kind of going through a hard time at that time. And we won't get into the details. But he was really praying hard about something. And so he walks in. Teresa and I were like halfway done with our meal. And so I looked over at Teresa and I said, hey, what if we pay for Pastor Earl's lunch? We won't tell him, okay? And so when we were done, you know, I went up to the waitress. I said, hey, you know, you see that couple over there? Can we pay for their lunch as well? And she kind of looked at me like, wow, okay. You know, she was surprised because I guess it's not a very common thing that everybody does, right? Which is understandable. And so, you know, I go there, I take care of our bill, I take care of their bill, and then you say, okay, bye, you know, have a wonderful birthday, and so off we went. And so later on, you know, Pastor Earl, he texts me, he said, hey, you sucker, all right? If you guys know Pastor Earl, right? Hey, you, what you did that for? Hey, you know. So we're kind of just joking around about it, and so I said, you know what, you deserve it, you know? And we just wanted to do something nice. You know, as manini as that, as something as small as that, you know, just receive it. And so, you know, for Teresa and myself, even it was just to put a little smile on his face that day, okay? And so when friends become family when you're able to recognize how somebody you truly care about, there's a change in their mood, or there's a change in something. There's maybe they're thinking about something and it's weighing heavy on their mind, right? Friends become family when they're able to recognize that and not maybe remedy the situation. You know, you don't want to necessarily solve that problem for them. But really, friends become family when you offer them different perspectives, right? If you guys know me, I love that word perspectives. Because when we stay open to perspectives, I believe we become a better person, right? But it does matter how you process these perspectives, okay? So kind of going on from there. Focusing on others is always meaningful and edifying. And what does that mean? It means you take your eyes off of yourself and you put them on other people. When we look at Hiro Hamada, 14 years old. Now, automatically we can say, well, Hiro is very young. He's very immature. He's very naive. All he thinks about himself is he thinks that the universe revolves around him, right? And we kind of get around teenagers, and that's not very hard to believe, right? Because we see, and in my experience, I've seen a lot of young kids, and they truly think that the world revolves around them. And that's because they're in their youth, they haven't had enough perspective, okay? And so for Hiro, his brother Tadashi was trying to say, hey man, you know, you're talented, but consider this. Consider going to nerd school, right? Consider living a life that is beyond chicken fighting. Consider living a life that getting involved in something that you were created to do, right? You have the smarts, you have the intelligence. Use it for good. So you see how Tadashi was giving him perspectives. So when we focus on others, there's always meaning behind it, but it's also edifying. It builds that person up, right? How many of you have ever come across, you know, people that say, well, you know, I don't know what the Lord has planned for my life. I don't know what the purpose of my life is. My encouragement for that is just keep on trucking, because the Lord will reveal it to you. But pay attention, because the Lord will speak not only to you, but the people around you as well. Amen? Moving on because of time. God handcrafted us to help people, never to hurt them. Okay? So you have talents, you have gifts. God made you to help other people, not hurt them. And the reason why I say hurt them is because, again, Hiro was using his talent to try and commit murder, essentially. Okay? And we'll get into that a little bit later. Paul the Apostle, he said this. He said, don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. Be humble, thinking of others as better than yourselves. Now, humility is thinking of yourself less, not thinking less of yourself. Okay? Humility is thinking of yourself less, meaning you have a healthy self-image because you understand who created you and what you're created to do. So you have a very healthy self-image, but you think of others before you think of yourself. Okay? Again, I say humility is not thinking less of yourself, but it's thinking of yourself less. Can I get an amen? Jesus took it a step further. He commanded us, love each other in the same way I have loved you. There is no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friends. You know, Teresa and I, we were talking about, you know, what does it mean to be a living sacrifice, right? Now, there's no one definition to define what being a living sacrifice is, but I offered her this perspective. I said, you remember when Paul said this, you know, when he kind of defined humility for us. And you remember when Jesus said this, when he commanded us to love. Okay? Psalm 139 says, you made all the delicate inner parts of my body and knit me together in my mother's womb. Thank you for making me so wonderfully complex. Your workmanship is marvelous, how well I know it. You watched me as I was being formed in utter seclusion, as I was woven together in the dark of the womb. You saw me before I was born. Every day of my life was recorded in your book. Every moment was laid out before a single day had passed. So this speaks to how God formed us. Now you see that phrase, inner parts. Everybody say inner parts. Inner parts in the Hebrew is kilia. I thought this was fascinating. Okay, and this is... You may think I'm kind of weird for thinking this way, but makes sense to me. Inner parts in Hebrew means kilia, or literally it means kidneys. So I was like, kidneys? Okay. 1 Corinthians 12 says, the human body has many parts, but the many parts make up one whole body. So it is with the body of Christ. Now we are all many parts, but we are all one body. So the idea is this, kidneys. What are the functions of a kidney? Kidneys purify the blood flow. Kidneys also regulate the water, okay, in your body. Okay, so it purifies all that. Now, you know, I like to think of the blood flow between the relationships we have. So we can think of the blood as the relationships or the interaction that we have with one another. And it is the love of Christ that keeps that blood pure. So you see that idea? The water, who is the water? The living waters, Jesus Christ, or the love that is between us. Amen? You see the idea? All right. So cilia, kidneys. Verse 9, Ecclesiastes chapter 4, two people are better off than one, for they can help each other succeed. If one person falls, the other can reach out and help. But someone who falls alone is in real trouble. Okay. Number 2, right ahead, go ahead and write in your notes, when you fall, fall on somebody. Not somebody, somebody. Which implies that you have a relationship with this person, okay? When you fall, fall on somebody. And that's why I appreciate the ministry that Kurt has, because he's offering you buddyship. Amen. You see that, man? You see that? You know, sometimes, you know, when we fall, when we think of falling, we're not thinking of physically falling, but we think of spiritually falling. Okay, and that's what I mean. When you're just about to, you know, you're tempted, and then you spiritually fall, fall on somebody. You find an accountability partner to say, "Hey, this is what I'm struggling with. I need your help." Okay, in confidentiality, if you wish. Okay. Amen. Blind spots. I want to talk about blind spots. You know, we have house full of teenagers right now that are learning how to drive. And when you get from the highway and you want to get onto the freeway, blind spots, you guys know what I'm talking about, right? You got to kind of look over your shoulder a little bit. And sometimes you don't see the car because they're kind of in between your side mirror and your rear view mirror, and you can't see them depending on what kind of vehicle that you have. And so we're there to help each other out. But really, friends become family. Friends become family when you point out the blind spots to each other, okay? And Teresa is good at this. She tells me all my blind spots, which I appreciate, right?
Do that with love.
Yes, do that with love, okay? And of course, we cover all that with love. But, you know, Teresa says, "Hey, you know, you're defensive all the time, you know, and you say this and you say that." So, okay, yeah, and I realize, you know, all these different things, but really, blind spots, okay? Friends become family when you have the courage enough to say, "Hey, man, you know, this is what's up," okay? You might want to consider changing that about yourself, okay? It may be in the form of being condescending or being too critical or being defensive. Maybe you have a temper problem. You have to go to, you know, anger management and all these kinds of things, okay? So find somebody that's able to speak that into your life and help you overcome, right? Blind spots. Verse 11, okay, as we're winding down. "Likewise, two people lying close together can keep each other warm, but how can one be warm alone? A person standing alone can be attacked and defeated, but two can stand back to back and conquer. Three are even better, for a triple-rated cord is not easily broken." Now that's the home run passage right there. Three are even better, for a triple-rated cord is not easily broken. Go ahead and write in your notes. Last point. You can be attacked when you're alone, but you can conquer with a companion. And that also speaks to, you know, talking with a lot of people, counseling a lot of people, and you go through different struggles in life, right? The first thing people tend to do is isolate themselves, okay? And we got to be careful about these kinds of things. Friends become family when you recognize these signs in the people that you care about, and they tend to isolate themselves. When you isolate themselves, that's when the devil comes in and wreaks havoc on your mind. Can I get an amen? And then they see themselves out of the fellowship. When you're feeling down and you're just about to fall, right? Right? Like I said, you know, fall on somebody. Go find somebody and just strengthen that connection, right? A three-braided cord is not easily broken. So you can be attacked when you're alone, but you can conquer with a companion. Just a really quick story. There was a soldier, and I shared this before, but this is a wonderful illustration. A soldier came back from the Middle East, and he was experiencing post-traumatic stress. They tried to help him recover, but he couldn't. And so he would lie down in the hospital bed, curled up in a fetal position, just like this. He couldn't rest because of all the nightmares he was experiencing. So they found out that his battle buddy was coming home from the war zone, and they called him up, and he said, hey, you know, so-and-so needs help. Will you come? And so his battle buddy came, crawled into bed with him, and they lie down in fetal positions back to back like this. Just how, you know, and his buddy was over here, just how they were in the foxhole, okay? So they were back to back. It was only up until that point where the first soldier was able to find rest because they watched each other's back when they were on the battlefield, okay? So the idea is, when you're alone, you can get attacked, but when you're with a buddy, you have a 360-degree view, okay? And you're able to protect each other and look out each other, for each other and literally have each other's back, amen? Here we see, I won't get into this, but this is, I had the idea of bungee cords, right? Bungee cords. So on the left, they melt the rubber and then they form it into ribbons. But what's interesting is in the right picture right there, you see a picture of three rubber bands. And it goes through a machine and they braid it together, and what you get, bungee cords, right? And of course, bungee cords is something that we take for granted, but if you have a kayak, if you have a surfboard or whatever, you're very familiar with bungee cords. And also, some of you may have been brave enough to do this. Right? So we know that the strength of bungee cords, right? How many of you guys have ever bungee jumped? Nobody in this room. Here is a picture. Who? Did you really? Oh. Okay. Well, one of these days I'm going to have you come up here and share with everybody. Here is a picture of Teresa and myself on our 20th anniversary. No, I'm kidding. This is not us. But the idea here is, you see, right? Husband, wife, bungee cord, right? Three. In the Hebrew culture, three is a very significant number because it's the number of completion, it's the number of stability, okay? We think of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. We think of husband and wife and Jesus, you see? We also think of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So three is a very significant number in the Hebrew culture. There is power in the number three, and the significance of the three braided cord. So as we finish up, okay, I want to call the worship team back up here for some nice patting music as we close up the message. I want to finish up with an acrostic that I came up with, CORD. Okay, C stands for comfort. Okay, in a triple braided cord, you find comfort. Jesus said, and he promises that there will be trials and tribulations in our life, right? But in the midst of all that, we can find peace. We can find comfort because we're not going at life alone. Remember once again, brothers and sisters, that we are designed for relationships. We are designed for companionships. Jesus Christ himself, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, who is involved in an eternal dance, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, the triune God, the Holy Trinity, he exemplifies for us relationships. Amen. And in these relationships, you can find comfort. Number two, O stands for opportunities to give, but also opportunities to receive, right? So again, friends become family when they comfort each other. Friends become family when they also look for opportunities to give without expecting anything in return, but also receiving. Now, for me, I had to learn how to receive because I'd rather give. Amen. I'd rather give to people whatever I can. And I, you know, people would often, you know, give back to me. Not that I was expecting or anything like that, but I really had a hard time receiving. But I want to encourage you, brothers and sisters, that receiving is part of that reciprocation that God wants us to experience, right? Because when you receive from others, it's a blessing to them. Amen? Okay. So friends become family when you look for opportunities to give and receive. Friends also become family when you have the courage enough to rebuke one another. You know, I give that example of when Teresa rebuked me for pointing out my blind spots. Okay? But it's opportunities like that. When you say, hey man, you know, you're messing up in this area, you need to get that in check, right? And that's exactly what Brother Kurt is offering to us once again. He says, hey, you know, if you're struggling with this, stop it. Here's how we can help. Okay? It's a rebuke. In love. Friends become family when they rebuke in love. And of course, friends become family when they defend one another. To defend is really to strengthen one another, okay? Because you think of a fortress, you know, and you think of the defenses, you think of a big wall. You know, we talked about the wall of Jericho, but also iron sharpening iron. Proverbs 28 tells us that, where we get around each other and we sharpen one another, amen? We become stronger when we are together, okay? So friends become family when we help each other, when we encourage one another, and we defend one another against the enemy. Amen? So that we don't fall to sin. Amen. Okay? So let's pray. With every head bowed and every eye closed, Father God, we come before you. We thank you for this time together, Lord, to teach us once again your truths in your word. Heavenly Father, I thank you for all my brothers and sisters here who are faithful to come to give you glory, to proclaim you always in our life, never first, but to proclaim your lordship only in our lives. Brothers and sisters, if you are here this morning and you do not know our Lord Jesus Christ, I want to give you an opportunity to make him the Lord of your life this morning. Because there is a forgiveness by his grace that he extends to everyone. He doesn't care what kind of background you're from. He doesn't care what the color of your skin is or the color of your hair. He doesn't care if you're Haole, Filipino, Japanese, Portuguese, Hawaiian. He doesn't care about all that stuff. He loves all of us. He forgives you. He forgives us for all the dumb stuff that we've done in the past. And it is available to everyone. And the reason why he does that, brothers and sisters, is because it is impossible to allow sin into heaven where he's calling you. He's calling us into his home. And so with that said, Lord God, if you're here today and you want to turn from your old ways, do it. Turn from your old ways and proclaim heaven to be your home. If that's you, brothers and sisters, with a show of hands, just go ahead and raise them. I see you, brother. I see you, brother. Praise the Lord. I see you, brother. You can put your hands down. Maybe there's some of you here that have maybe walked away a little bit. Maybe some of you have been following the Lord, walking with the Lord when you were younger. Something happened in life. You know, we all maybe kind of lose our attention, our focus on God. We get distracted with life. The Holy Spirit now is calling you home. If you hear that still small voice in your heart this morning to say, come home, come home. If that's you, brothers and sisters, just go ahead and raise your hand. Yes. He sees you, sister. He sees you, sister. So repeat after me, brothers and sisters. Father God, nice loud voice. Father God, I declare my love for you. I thank you for coming to me and reaching out to me. So now I reach back to you. I declare, Lord Jesus, you are my Lord. I no longer want to live in my old ways. I want to live in my new life with you. I confess that I am a sinner, and I also confess my need of a Savior. Lord Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross for me. Thank you for washing me clean. For I am a new creation. And devil, get away from me. You have no power over me. Because Jesus reigns over me. Hallelujah. It is in His name I pray. And all in agreement say, Amen. 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 Well, praise the Lord.